Good afternoon and welcome to Data in the IEDB, a virtual tour. My name is Nina Blazeska and I'm the project manager of the Immune Epitope Database. Thank you all for joining us virtually this afternoon or whatever time it may be in your part of the world. As you'd obviously be aware, and like with many other events so far this year, we have pivoted away from in-person meetings and are excited to bring you our very first IEDB webinar, with hopefully more to come in the future. Today, we'll be taking you on a virtual behind-the-scenes tour of the IEDB, from curation of information to actually querying the database itself. We'll have two of our team's experts taking you on this journey, Nima, our senior curator, and Randi, our lead ontology and quality manager. The agenda for the webinar will be a brief background on the IEDB, led by Nima, followed by a video of the curation process that the team has put together for your viewing. Then Randi will take us through a live demonstration as she queries the IEDB using two key examples, the 1918 influenza and coronavirus data that is currently available. Finally, Randi and Nima will be joined by IEDB PIs, Alex Sette and Bjorn Peters for our Q&A. The team will be answering some pre-submitted questions from you, our audience, and also questions that are submitted live during the webinar. There is a Q&A functionality at the bottom of your Zoom screen, so feel free to submit any questions throughout the webinar, and we will try our best to answer as many as possible towards the end. Lastly, this webinar will be recorded, so we'll share the link with you in a follow-up email when it's available. Feel free to share this link with any of your colleagues who you think may be interested. And now, without further ado, I would like to pass it over to Nima to kick us off. Thanks very much, Nima.
Thank you, Nina. My name is Nima Salimi. I'm a member of the IEDB team. I would like to join Nina and welcome you all to this first of its kind IEDB virtual webinar. And I'd like to begin by briefly providing you with some background information about the IEDB project. So the IEDB is an NIAID-funded project founded in 2003, and we provide the scientific community with free access to epitope data as well as to epitope prediction and analysis tools. So this presentation today will focus primarily on the epitope database component of the IEDB, which currently houses approximately 1 million epitopes and 2.5 million assays related to T-cell, B-cell epitopes, as well as peptides that are shown to bind to MHC molecules. So the scope encompasses both linear and discontinuous peptides, as well as non-peptidic epitopes that are recognized by humans, primates, mice, and any other species for which data is available. The epitope sources range from microbes to allergens, autoantigens, and transplantation antigens. A significant part of the IEDB utility derives from the contextual nature of the data. So in other words, the IEDB houses not only the sequence and the chemical structures of the epitopes, but also the actual primary data associated with them. And it's for this reason that it can be a valuable research tool for everything from basic immunological research to vaccine development. The IEDB is a continuously evolving resource, and its development is driven primarily by our interactions with our users, such as this one. And this is why today's session is invaluable to us, and we would like to strongly encourage your questions and input. And to close this brief introduction, I'd like to note that, as I mentioned, the vast majority of the IEDB data are derived from peer-reviewed publications, in fact, over 21,000 of them. Achieving this, of course, requires a team of expert curators who read and interpret each manuscript in order to extract the relevant data. So therefore, we would like to begin with a brief video that will introduce you to some of our IEDB team members, and also at the same time familiarize you with the life cycle of the IEDB data. We'd like to apologize in advance that the video may not play fluidly for some attendees, and that's a Zoom issue, but we will have a link to the YouTube posting of this video that you will receive in a follow-up email that you can follow and view in the future. So let's begin by watching that brief video.
Thank you for your interest in the IEDB. My name is Nima Salimi, and I'm part of the IEDB team. In this short video, my colleagues and I will give you a behind-the-scenes look at the process of populating the IEDB with data. Peer-reviewed publications are one of the primary sources of the data in the IEDB. A team of scientists called curators read and systematically extract the relevant information from these publications. This process is called curation. But before the curation process begins, the papers that are potentially relevant to the current IEDB scope, including infectious diseases, autoimmunity, and allergy, need to be identified from over 27 million publications cataloged in PubMed. This task is led by IEDB document specialist Lindy Edwards. Lindy, can you please provide us a brief overview of this process?
Sure. We've created a customized PubMed query that is run on a biweekly basis. The retrieved records are analyzed by an automated text classifier to identify any records that are unlikely to contain information that is relevant to the IEDB, known as uncuratable. The potentially curatable papers are sorted into broad categories and subcategories. For example, allergen pollen or infectious disease pox viruses. At this point, the potentially curatable abstracts are manually scanned by a senior immunologist on the team to confirm the accuracy of the classifier. We also rely on input from our users in order to make sure that we haven't missed anything.
Thanks, Lindy. In the next step, this list of papers enters the curation pipeline, where the curators will read and extract the data. The papers are assigned to curators based on the nature of the data described in the paper. For example, we have curators who specialize in curating papers describing non-peptidic epitopes, 3D structures, and papers reporting T-cell or B-cell receptor information. To capture the relevant data from the papers, each curator uses a web-based data entry portal consisting of both free text and controlled value data fields that help ensure data consistency. Debbie Shackelford, one of our IEDB senior curators, will now take us on a brief tour of the curation process using the curation system.
Thank you, Nima. The curation aims to objectively represent all the data that meet minimal IEDB inclusion criteria. To demonstrate the types of information extracted for the IEDB, the following paper is used as an example. In it, the authors use a conserved epitope found in the membrane proximal stem of influenza virus hemagglutinin and express it in a virus-like particle and then determine if it's sufficiently immunogenic to induce broadly neutralizing antibodies. I've highlighted two key words that are in the PubMed query Lindy just described that was used to identify the paper. The data entry process begins by adding a single epitope. The epitope structure, whether peptidic or non-peptidic, must be clearly provided in the manuscript or in a reference. Figure 1 in the paper provides a sequence of the 20 amino acid peptide found in the hemagglutinin of the 1918 flu. The epitope sequence is entered into the epitope field of the IEDB curation application. Each naturally occurring epitope is then assigned a source. The edit link accesses the molecule finder, which is used to find sources with 100% sequence match to the epitope. The molecule finder contains a subset of the entries you would find in GenBank and is continually amended as new sources are needed. In this case, multiple GenBank accessions contain the epitope sequence and the most appropriate is chosen. Once an epitope has been added, details summarizing the assays in which the epitope reactivity are tested are captured. In this case, a B-cell assay is used to capture antibody reactivity by ELISA. The assay details fields follow the temporal flow of the experiment, beginning with the host and immunization details, including the immunogen, the dose and additional details, followed by the type of assay utilized, the assayed antibody, and the antigen used to elicit the response in the assay. There are custom sets of fields for B-cell, T-cell, MHC binding, and ligand elution assays. Additional details, such as MHC restriction and antibody isotype and sequencing, are also included when available in the manuscript. Automated validation based on relationships between data fields is extensively incorporated throughout the system in order to alert the curator of errors in real time. But once all of the information has been curated, the data can be advanced to our peer review stage.
Thanks, Debbie. As Debbie mentioned, an important final step in the curation workflow is the internal peer review process. Randi, the IEDB Quality Control Manager, will provide an overview of this process.
Once a curator has entered all of the data for a given publication, the record is sent to peer review, where a senior curator rereads the same paper again and reviews how that data was entered into the IEDB's curation interface. We do this to ensure consistency across all of the different publications and among all of our different curators, following established IEDB curation guidelines. In addition to manual review, we also have interfield validation that's built into the curation interface itself. This validation checks for things like consistency among fields. For example, if the curator accidentally entered a greater number of subjects responding than were tested, you would get a validation error that looks like this. Both the curator and the reviewer can see these validation errors, and they must be resolved in order to promote any reference to the external website. Once the curator and the reviewer agree on how the data was entered and all of the validation errors are resolved, the data is then made public.
Upon passing these quality assurance and quality check steps, the data are made publicly visible in the IEDB website. The homepage provides summary metrics detailing the type and amount of data available. We always welcome your questions at help@iedb.org. Thanks again for your interest in the IEDB.
Hi, this is Randi Vita. Can you see my screen? I don't know if anyone can tell me. But this is the homepage of the website, and I'm going to walk through how you can access and view the data once it gets put onto the external site. So this is our homepage, as Nima had shown you. And over on the far left, we have some information about ourselves, about the project. And if you click on the Learn More, you can go to links giving a great deal more detail about all of us and our project, including how to cite the IEDB and access to our curation rules. We also have a section on upcoming events. Typically, we go to conferences throughout the year and have an IEDB booth where we can interact with the public and do one-on-one queries. However, this year, as with many projects, most of those events have been canceled, but you can always find what we're going to do here, including this webinar. And in the future, we'll have a webinar on the epitope analysis resource, and that will show up here. And we do have an annual workshop that this year will be entirely remote, making it easier to attend, and that you can register for that here, and it will be an end of October. We also have the summary metrics, as Nima showed, and this is updated every week as we add new data. And at the bottom of the page, you can find links to our help features. You can give us feedback because we want to hear from you. And if you ever find anything out there you think should be the IEDB and isn't, please let us know. You can ask questions. We'll help you with your queries. And then the Solution Center is full of articles detailing lots of different concepts about the data in the IEDB. And the tools licensing information will be covered in a future tools webinar. The center of the page is the main search interface, which I'm going to go over in detail. And on the far right is the information about the epitope analysis resource. We have T-cell tools, B-cell tools, and epitope analysis tools. And each of these links takes you to further details, and this will be covered in a future webinar by the tools team. And throughout the page, you'll see these little question marks next to many terms. And those are, if you mouse over them or click on them, they'll pop up and give you a little bit more information about what we intend by that term. And then the Learn More will take you to an article giving much more detail about that whatever that question mark is next to. So in this case, it's about the epitope. So the search interface is divided into these six search panes. And this is based on the search parameters that our users most often use and most often have requested. We have a lot more search parameters, but we don't want to overcomplicate things from the start. So we've narrowed it to these six key features. So for the epitope search pane, you can search on features of the epitope, whether it's the type, non-peptidic, discontinuous, or linear, or whether you have a specific peptide and you want to enter its sequence and see what data is known for it. You can enter that here, and you can do an exact match, or blast match, or substring match. And the next box is the antigen. This is what the epitope is derived from. Did it come from a specific organism or a particular protein of interest for you? You can enter those here. The host is whose immune response is being measured. And we have data on any host that appears in the literature. It includes humans and mice, but any other cats, dogs, cows, camels, anything that is published, we have data for it. The assay, by default, we include all assay types and select positive only. However, you can uncheck the positive if you don't want it, or if you're interested in just antibody or T-cell assays or MHC ligand assays, you can check or uncheck as you wish. And then you can search for specific assay types in the neutralization box. The MHC restriction search pane lets you search by class or non-classical, or you can enter a specific allele if that's interesting to you. And the disease search pane, this is about the disease of the host whose immune response is being studied. So, you know, did they have a dengue viral infection? And then they mounted an immune response to dengue epitopes. And then once you've built your query, you hit the search box at the bottom. And we let you select multiple parameters from all the boxes or none of the boxes. You can just search and get all of our data. And a key feature of each of these boxes is autocomplete. So if you start typing all of the terms for which we have data, which is based on what's been in the literature, will pop up. And additionally, we have these finder boxes that when you open them, you get access to what types of terms we have data for. So this is NCBI taxonomy to organize the hosts, but it will show you, if you wanted to browse through it, what types of hosts we have data for. It also organizes them. If you're interested in mammals and not fish or birds, you can pick a higher level, or if you're interested in all primates, you can search at that level, or you can find a specific one of interest. And this just lets you get a good idea what sort of data we have, and it's all organized using the NCBI hierarchy. And each of these finders is similar to that. They show you what we have data for, and the disease ontology is used for the disease finder. The MHC restriction ontology is used for the MHC finder, which organizes our MHC molecules by class and by species. And again, you can see all of the different terms for which we have data to date. And the assay finder is the ontology for biomedical investigations. And then I'm gonna do a query here. I'm starting with what Debbie just showed you, what she had curated was an epitope from a specific strain of the 1918 flu. So I'm gonna use one of our autocomplete features that lets me quickly find what I'm looking for by typing minimal information. Because we use these external resources, we gain all of the synonyms that are built in. And this lets you search much more easily using common terms. So I started typing South Carolina because I happened to know that was the strain from her paper. And I was able to pull up this complicated formal taxonomic term. So that is a great feature of using these other resources. So for my query, all I'm doing is querying for that specific strain of influenza, and then I'm gonna hit search. But you could pick as many things as you want from all of the boxes, or you can pick nothing. So when I hit search, I get to the results page. And I had picked linear epitope unintentionally, so I'm gonna take it off and research. So on the results page, over on the far left, there's the search panes that you had seen on the homepage with a few extra features added. So we've added a few extra terms here to allow search on more detailed information, like if you're interested in all 3D structure data, or if we wanted to look for modifications on the epitope, we can find those here. And we've also added here a finder to find specific non-peptidic epitopes like penicillin or nickel or any other allergens or carbohydrates that you might be interested in. And we've added a search pane for receptor. So we do capture TCR and antibody sequence information in the IEDB. And if you want all records having that data, you hit this checkbox. Or if you can search for specific TCR or BCR information, you can search for specific CDR1, 2, or 3 sequences, doing a substring match or identity match or an exact match. The assay finder and the MHC and the host and the disease finders are all the same as they were on the homepage. And then we've added one last new finder, the reference finder. So as Nima mentioned, most of our data is from the literature, but we do have submissions. And if you were interested in distinguishing between those types of records, you can do that here. You can also search for your favorite author or yourself. You can search for titles or keywords for journal articles or the subject from the abstract. And then you, if you want to narrow your results, particular date range, you can do that here. And anytime you've added anything here that you haven't yet put into your query, the box will turn green again and tell you to search again. So here we have all of the results presented on these different tabs. And above the tabs is the pending filters for what your query, what this data relates to that query. And in this case, this query is only all data from this very specific strain of the 1918 flu. So we have 11 epitopes derived from that strain on the epitopes tab. And on this tab, you'll see there's a table with columns, and these headers are sortable. So if you click on this little arrow, it'll sort by that feature. And then we also have details, which if you click on these, it takes you to more details about that particular row. And the sort of structure repeats throughout. And the little filter box will filter to data just about that row. So then the next tab over is the antigens tab. This is the protein, in this case, because it's a peptidic epitope that these epitopes were derived from. The assay tab is further subdivided into additional T-cell, B-cell, and MHC ligand assay tabs, because each of the assay types has slightly different column headers. And again, you can sort on any of these column headers and filter on anything that you see a little funnel next to. So if you only wanted pig data, you could filter for that here. And then the receptors tab, this gives you the antibody and TCR sequence information for when we have it, as provided by the publications. And then lastly, we have the reference tab. And on the reference tab, you'll see all of the papers that were curated separately by different curators over time and published over time based on their dates, you can see. And then I'm going to narrow down to just the paper that Debbie just showed you so that I can look at specifically that data. And I'm going to do it by hitting the little funnel. And then now you'll see that that's been added, that search parameter's added at the top. And now I'm looking at just that epitope that was just seen in the video by Debbie. So she added that epitope for this paper from that strain. And if I go to the assays tab, I'll see all of the experiments that she curated for the epitope. So she curated a total of 8. And the one in detail that we were looking at just now was this one. And so this looks very similar to what Debbie had shown. This is her record now on the external site joined with all the other data. So the top detail for assays is related to where the data came from. This is the reference that it was taken from. Then we have a section on the epitope. So this is all of the data. She entered that peptide and she selected this particular human glutenin. And we have link outs along the right side to other resources as they relate. So this is the link to that GenBank record that she selected. And this is the link to the NCBI taxonomy strain for that strain of flu. Then there's a section on the immunization. The mouse was immunized with the epitope as Debbie entered it. And these are her comments. And then there's a section on the assay itself. And when you're in the assay itself, you can see that the data was taken from very specific figures in the paper. And you can also see the number of subjects tested and responded entered correctly as it had to be in order for this record to make it to the external website. But this is a very narrow search. So what I'm showing you is one assay from one paper, from one strain. And the real value of the IEDB comes from all the data being put together. So I cleared all my pending filters and now I'm gonna do a much broader search just on influenza A virus. So the goal of the IEDB is to put all the data that's out there together in one place so you can find it and use it. And so now you can see we have nearly 8,000 epitopes from influenza. And the default sort value on these tables is by the rows having the most data. So this particular epitope has the most assays and is derived from the most number of references. But if you were to export this, and over here on the right, I'll show you, we have a little export feature. You can export the results in various ways. You would see that we have some epitopes that are very limited, studied in very limited experiments, and some that are studied a great deal. And the value of putting this all together is for to give you a whole picture of what's known about any particular protein or any particular pathogen of interest or allergen or autoantigen. So on the antigens tab now, we see all the proteins from influenza A. So this represents the reference proteome of influenza A. And for each protein, we have a different number of epitopes that have been tested. Some proteins aren't studied very much. Some proteins, hemagglutinin and nucleoprotein, are studied a great deal, as you probably would imagine. So I want to show you a feature that's on the antigens tab. This little graph icon is an immunome browser. And when you go to the page for the first time, this pop-up is already open. But if you mouse over it, it'll come back. So the immunome browser is a tool that we have that I'm going to demonstrate that plots all of the data we have onto the protein. So it's per protein basis on all the epitopes that meet your query criteria. And if you click on this Learn More, it will take you to our Help Center and an article that goes into way more detail than I can get into today on how it works. But I'm going to click on it. If it doesn't load fast, I'm going to go to my previous one that I loaded earlier. Nope, it's not working either. Good. So this is the hemagglutinin from influenza A that I had just queried and clicked on. And this is all of the data plotted onto the reference protein. So this is amino acid 1 of hemagglutinin, amino acid 88, amino acid 320, to the very end of the protein. So this is the full length of the protein. The top graph shows you the response frequency, so how frequently were subjects responding to each region of the protein. So these are, you know, regions from amino acid 120 to 130. And the lower graph shows you the number of assays that were positive or negative. So blue represents a positive spike, so many assays there were positive, and red shows you that assays were negative along that region. And for some proteins, you'll see areas where it's blank, and that means no one has studied that region. Hemagglutinin is very highly studied, so there's some experiments along the full length of this protein. And you can see peaks where there was a greater response. And this graph shows all data for influenza. My query parameters are shown up at the top, so it just says influenza A virus. But you could further narrow it to just a human response or an antibody response. And I did that earlier. And this here is still influenza, but this is just a human antibody response. I removed T-cell assays and actually ligand assays. And you can see that it's quite a different graph. So the antibody response seems to be much wider, and the peaks are slightly different from what we saw in the general all data from all species and all assay types. So you have to perform the query that's relevant to you to make the immunome browser the most meaningful for what you're interested in. So again, going back to the query results, we can see that we have far more assays now that we have all influenza, 31,000 different assays, both T-cell, B-cell, and MHC binding assays and ligand elution assays. We have a great deal of receptor information. There are a lot of TCR sequences and antibody sequences known that are specific to flu epitopes, and then a much larger number of references, 1,500. And now the last query that I'm going to do, something that many people are interested in, is coronavirus. So I'm starting with a really broad search of just coronavirus to show you what we have. So to date, we have 5,000 epitopes from coronavirus, and this is because the IEDB has always been interested in infectious diseases from its start. So we've always curated infectious disease data, and coronavirus data has always been out there as it causes common colds, it causes SARS and MERS. So that's how we have accumulated so much data to date. And this data comes from a large number of antigens, and like I said, a lot of it's SARS and MERS related. And I'm going to go to the reference tab to show you that we are slowly accumulating new data related to the 2020 outbreak as it comes in. We're very committed to getting this data curated as fast as possible and getting it onto the website as soon as we can. So we are prioritizing this data as it gets published. But I did also want to show that if we limit our search to just the new strain that's causing so much trouble, we see that we only have one epitope so far. That's because a lot of those papers are looking at what's already known rather than the new strain. So even though there are papers about the new coronavirus outbreak, they're using data related to other strains, but that shouldn't slow anyone down, because all of that 5,000 epitopes that are already in there, they can be still used, and we did use them. So we performed an analysis of the immune response to SARS-CoV-2 using the predictions based on the IEDB data, and you can access that here. This link takes you to this paper, and Alex and Bjorn are both on the call if you want to talk to them. I really recommend reading this paper. It shows you the immune targets that are predicted for the current outbreak of coronavirus. And then now we're going to go to the question and answer portion. And there was one question that came up that I'm going to go ahead and answer, and that was about the immunome browser and what search parameters can be used with it. So you can use whatever search parameters you choose here on the homepage or on the results page. You can make it as complicated or as simple as you want, as long as it works per protein. So if I change my query to humans and Timothy grass, and a T cell response, these same parameters and will get projected onto the immune browser when I click on it, when it loads, and then you see everything that I searched on up here. So it will be as simple, as complicated as you want it to be based on what sort of research you're doing. So now I'm gonna hand it over to Nima.
Thank you, Randi. So yes, as Randi mentioned, we're gonna stay with question and answer and devote the following segment to continuing to answer questions. As Nima mentioned at the beginning, we're gonna try to get to all your questions as they come in, but if we're not able to, we will surely follow up offline. So as Randi mentioned, we're joined by Alex and Bjorn, our PIs. And the first question is regarding a question about submitted experimental data that is not currently in the IEDB. And specifically, this question inquired about proprietary data, such as from a pharmaceutical company. So Alex, would you mind addressing this question a little bit further?
Okay, I'll start over unmuted. It's a very good question. It relates to the fact that there is a lot of interest and activity of companies using proteins as biologics. And oftentimes, protein that is used as a drug becomes immunogenic. And obviously, to have antibodies against a drug, like, for example, EPO or an antibody or whatever, is not good. So the question was, what is the IEDB doing? What are the strategies to collect this data? So in general, if studies are published and appear in the scientific literature regarding immunogenicity and defining what are the epitopes and maybe substitutions to decrease the immunogenicity, we capture that and we curate it. The vast majority of the data, however, is not published. And we would love if this data would become available. There has been some effort from the AbbVie-RISC consortium in Europe, and I think also AAPS had some initiative along those lines, but both databases had never been made, to the best of my knowledge, publicly available. So I think this would be a real benefit for the scientific community if this data would become more broadly available, because also this data could be used to train algorithms to specifically determine immunogenicity of protein used as biologics.
Thank you. Thank you, Alex, for that response. We have another question, pre-submitted question, and I'm gonna ask Randi to address this. The question is, can our results be exported? And if so, how?
The export is on each of the tabs. Every one of the epitopes, antigens, assays, receptors, there's no results on this one. They each have this little icon over in the upper right-hand corner, export results. And it shows you two different formats that you can export them. And I'll explain those really quickly here, but those question marks explain it further. The export CSV file has the data exported into an Excel readable file. The IRIs is additional information about the link outs to other resources and ontologies that we use for each term. So if you're not interested in those, you can take the top one, but if you want the additional ontology information or other resource links, you can use the lower one. And then we do have one other way to access the data. Under More IEDB, the database export, if you click on that, it will take you to a page with a large number of export options. XML, the schema, MySQL database export, ERD diagram, CSV metric exports, and some ID exports. And all of these are freely available and they're all updated every week.
So staying with you, Randi, this question deals with B-cell epitopes. And the question is, how do I find out the total number of B-cell epitopes reported for an organism of interest? And can I distinguish between linear and discontinuous epitopes?
Okay, I'm gonna just keep sharing screen. So walk me through this again, Nima. If you're just looking for B-cell epitopes, just uncheck T-cell and MHC, and that gives you all B-cell epitopes. And I think you said organism of interest. Is that correct?
Yes. So,
so then
any organism of interest, I suppose.
I already did influenza and dengue, so I'll do coronavirus. So this would give you B-cell epitopes from coronavirus. And I saw another question about positive, negative, so I'm gonna answer that at the end of this. So then when you hit search, this is all positive assays for that species of interest, that are antibody. What was the rest of the question?
Can you distinguish the discontinuous from the continuous?
Well, if I can jump in, I think the question is, what's the difference between positive versus negative assays?
Oh yeah, that's a different question. I'm gonna do that last.
Oh, okay, sorry.
So discontinuous and linear, you could select that here if you wanted to only return discontinuous or linear. Or if you wanted to return both and just look at them side by side when you export it, if you included all, you would be able to tell the difference. Or let me do that. Discontinuous, just so you can see what they look like. The discontinuous ones will look like this. And so when they export, you will be able to tell them apart. But if you only want one or the other, you just use these radio buttons, which are on the home page and on the results page. And then that second question about positive, what does positive mean or negative mean? That's a very good question. And we leave that up to the authors. So it's totally based on what is in each publication. And different authors may have differing ideas about that. So they may, one of them may have really high background and call a lot of things negative, or another one might call everything positive. We leave it up to them because we're trying to reflect the literature. We're not trying to make judgments. We're unbiased. And if there is data that we can't tell if it's positive or negative, we don't curate it until we've clarified that with the author. We don't impart our own judgment.
Okay, thank you. This question I'm going to pose to either Alex or Bjorn. The question is, for SARS-CoV-2, i.e. the new strain, IEDB only has one reference, but for other strains, you have many references that can be used. How reliable are those other epitopes in terms of this new strain?
The strain information, in general, for all kind of species information, we are relying on the NCBI taxonomy, and the NCBI taxonomy at this stage has only one SARS-CoV-2 sequence in it, and a lot more from others. So we are anticipating that as these things get expanded in the NCBI taxonomy, we'll add things as well. So there's really currently a big catch-up by all kinds of people, Uniprot, GenBank, NCBI taxonomy, and others. And we are relying on, because we are relying on our annotations from them, we are putting them in there so far. And these things might change going forward. I hope that answers it.
Great, thank you. Randi, if I could ask you, are you sharing at the moment?
You want me to?
Yes, please. So a good question came in that was related to your presentation. Could you just briefly demonstrate where the modification list is so that if one were interested in searching for modified peptides, where that could be, that parameter could be specified, please?
Okay, so on the homepage, you can't pick that feature, but on the results page where we've added the additional search parameters, because this is less commonly searched for, the modifications would be here. And I think the question was specific about citrullination, which is common in the rheumatologic diseases. If you did this search, this would give us all peptides that are citrullinated, whether they're positive or negative, and regardless of any, you know, the context in which they were searched. So if you're interested in recognition of citrullinated peptides in specific disease, I would add the disease down here, or if it's specific animal model, we do also have animal models of autoimmune diseases. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Okay, Nina, how are we doing on timing here, please?
We've got plenty of time, so we can have a few more questions.
Okay, great. So another pre-submitted question was, how do I find data for in vivo protection?
Okay, I will go to that. So for each of our assay types, they reflect what we've seen in the literature. So it's we have both in vivo assays in T cell and B cell. And so the organization of the assay tree is based on the ontology for biomedical investigations to group similar assay types. So we have biological activity and qualitative finding separately. And in vivo is what I'm looking for. Here. So there's a node called in vivo assays. So this groups several different assays that are all performed in vivo. Separately, we also have neutralization. So some users might be interested in neutralization, but if you want specifically challenge assays or assays where decreased disease was tested, you should pick those. Or if you're interested in just seeing everything that we have, I would go with the in vivo node and then see what we have.
Okay. Question from one of the attendees is, if you're interested in following a set of proteins, is there a way to subscribe and set some keywords so that when new data for those targets is added, the user gets updated automatically? It's hard to keep up with newly added data on a regular basis.
Yeah, I thought I had typed an answer to that.
Oh, did you? Okay.
Yeah, that's okay. So no, Nana, at this time, but that's a good idea. We have been asked something similar to that before, so we will definitely add that to our wish list. And we do want ideas like that from our users.
Yes, I mean, certainly the export feature could be utilized to get a snapshot of what's available at any given time, and then one could go back and do that comparison as well.
Yeah, very good.
Okay. Sorry, I'm scrolling through. Feel free to jump in with any answers you'd like to do, but I'm looking at the other.
Qualitative and quantitative measures of binding affinity, do they come from the papers, and how do we normalize this in our data set? So we curate each paper separately, and we curate the binding affinity in each paper as stated by the authors. So we use exactly the values. The only thing that we do is we might change, you know, for on or off rates, we might change minutes to hours or hours to minutes, but we keep exactly what they entered. So the controls will differ across different papers, so we can't necessarily normalize for that. I don't know if Alex or Baron want to add anything else to that. We let each paper stand alone, and we trust that the authors and the journal editors did a good job vetting the data set.
Yeah, I don't have much to answer to that. And basically, the IEDB is important to emphasize that we curate the data that is published. So we do not run qualitative judgment calls and say this data, we like this data, we don't like this data. It's so whatever the paper reports is what the IEDB will curate.
And I see that there's a question that Bjorn wanted to answer on citrullination, on whether citrullination.
Yeah. Okay. So
immunogenicity.
Maybe Randi, you can go to the search page if you just search for integers in amino acid modification citrullination.
Yeah, I've already done that. That should be it's what you're seeing.
Still your screen, right? Okay, perfect. So essentially, okay, sorry. Then this is here. So essentially, there is no way of directly searching for increased immunogenicity. The way to do this was to take these downloads, make an export. Then you have essentially all the citrullinated peptides that are recognized, and then perform the same query without, and then use whatever your favorite scripting language is or Excel table or so, and look up which ones are found to be reactive with citrullination and non-reactive or not present without. That is not perfect, but essentially this data is very frequently also not available. I think in many cases you'll run into the case where people haven't done the comparison. So there's no direct query, but what I described right now is the best we can do at this point.
I want to restate that often papers will only test citrullinated or only test uncitrullinated. So you might need to compare from different authors and different experiments, and then you might get a slightly different host. So it is a little hard to do based on how the papers are published.
We did have a question regarding epitope predictions, specifically for SLA2 alleles, and we were able to verify that we currently do not have predictions for SLA2 alleles. However, I checked the database. Go ahead.
And actually, if you check the database and search for MHC ligand assays, where the restriction is MHC class 2 and PIG, which is SLA, you'll find a single peptide. So a single peptide is not enough to train anything on. So as more data becomes available, that should change.
I just had another question about cross-DB references. What cross-DB references are used in the IEDB?
And Randi, in your last query, you didn't have MHC ligand assays on. That's why you had lots more answers.
That's why I went to that tab.
Yeah, but most of those are T-cell assays. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, you want to do that? And do you want binding only?
Never mind. I think we should move on to the next question.
Okay, so I was going to talk about the cross-DB references. So when I was on the details page, hoping I still had it open. So when you're on a assay, details page is where it's the easiest place to see all of our cross-references. So we cross-reference to ourselves, which I guess doesn't count, but also we go use the PubMed ID. And then it depends on the resource that is available. So we link to ontology IDs for diseases. We're going to be adding them hopefully for disease stage. We link to organism IDs, the NC by tax ID. And then we use cell ontology and the cell line ontology to describe cells. And we also, I don't have a tissue here, we use Uberon for tissues. And for proteins, we use GenBank or Uniprot as appropriate. The assays are the ontology for biomedical interface. Oh, here's a tissue example. Each experiment will have slightly different choices depending on what parameters are used in that experiment. And then we do at the bottom of some epitope details pages, let me click on an epitope details page, and we have some additional link outs to other resources at the bottom of the page. In our cells, some tools. It depends on what's available for each type of data we're looking at, I think is the bottom line. But we always try and add new ones too. It's an ongoing mission to link to more and more resources as we can. And we link to KEBI and PubChem also for the non-peptidic structures.
We have an attendee who's interested in searching for data related to specific cytokines. For example, when they're reported as IF interferon gamma in the manuscript. Randi, could you show that in the assay finder? Great. Mm-hmm.
So if you open the experimental assay finder for T cell assays, we have all of the cytokines for which we've encountered in the literature to date for being a T cell response. There may be other cytokines that exist that weren't shown to be produced by T cells. There are a lot of dendritic cells expressing cytokines. But these are the ones for which we have data, and they're grouped together, again, using OBE, so that you can search for all interferon gamma assays together as one set. Or if you're only interested in a specific platform that was used, we have all of the ones we've encountered so far. So there's either slightly different platforms for interferon gamma than IL-1, as it was just been studied more in different ways. So if you did that search, my windows. There. So I'm doing just an interferon gamma search. This is all data for interferon gamma, with no other search parameters. That's a lot of epitopes.
Okay, thank you, Randi. I believe at this point, Nina, I'm gonna move ahead if that is okay with you.
No worries, Nima, thank you.
Okay, so just to summarize, we're hopeful that in this brief session, having gained some insights into the IEDB curation processes, as well as a brief introduction to the query functionalities, that the IEDB resource will prove useful for your own work. One quick reminder is that we are recording this session and a link will be shared with you after we're finished here. And another series of questions that came up were related to tools. So today's focus was primarily the database aspect of it, but we do have an annual workshop planned as well as possible tools session devoted specifically similar to this one to focus on tools. So we will reach out to you with updates about that. So at this time, on behalf of the entire IEDB team, I'd like to thank you all for your attendance. We would like to request that you take a moment to complete a brief survey about this session. If you have a moment after you close the meeting, a survey will pop up. It should take 5 minutes. But as this is our first virtual session, we would benefit tremendously from your input on how to fine-tune it in the future. So unless anybody else on the team has anything to add, I will thank everybody for attending. Nothing? All right. Thank you for your attendance once again. Please stay tuned for the survey.